On June 4th, 1976, a quarter of a century ago, four young men took to the stage of the Lesser Free Trade Hall in Manchester. The noise they made changed everything.
We never see ourselves as a punk band. We hated the term punk. We were the Sex Pistols.
I know that changed my life beyond a whole room full of shadows of doubt.
Oh, God.
Fantastic moments in punk history.
I swear I was there.
The two gigs that the Sex Pistols played in Manchester in 1976 inspired a generation of musicians. Without them, there'd be no Buzzcocks, no Magazine, no Smiths, no Joy Division, no New Order, no Factory Records, no Hacienda, no Madchester. Manchester was also the scene of the Pistols' first ever television appearance. These three events have been shrouded in mystery and misunderstanding for 25 years, until now. Three appearances that changed the course of rock music. And they were brought about by two students at the Bolton Institute of Technology, Pete McNeish and Howard Trafford.
I do remember going along to the college gigs, you know, that every Saturday night, and really getting very fed up of it and feeling, you know, I wish I could go and see the Stooges or something like that, something that's really going to be confrontational and aggressive and exciting and a bit dangerous.
Yeah, I tend to think of Howard as being very, you know, enigmatic, but really he's as mad as a brush.
The glam rock thing was over. It'd been the pub rock thing, which hadn't really made it. All the stuff, you know, the bands like Yes and, I don't know, Barclay James Harvest and the 1500 Wives of King Henry the 13th or whatever it was on ice. Didn't really touch a chord with the guys in the street from around my way.
It's hard to describe how bloody awful music was, how desperately bad it was, how all our 60s heroes had become boring and useless, and how the stuff that was happening then, I mean, not only was it bad, it was also, they were badly dressed.
Howard Trafford met Pete McNeish after putting up an advert for musicians at the Bolton Institute. McNeish was one of the few people who actually responded. The nucleus of a band began, but musically, it just wasn't happening.
Sort of February 1976, I don't think we really knew what kind of where any of this was going, except that we were vaguely still trying to get a band together. We were sat in the coffee bar at college on a Wednesday or a Thursday, whenever it was that New Musical Express came out in Bolton, and I'd kind of flipped through it, given it to Pete. He looked through it and he handed it back to me and said, "Did you read that?" And this was the famous review of, the first ever review of the Sex Pistols by Neil Spencer. Don't look over your shoulder, but the Sex Pistols are coming. Oh, whatever. And the Stooges were mentioned in there. And we're not into music, we're into chaos. There was that line in there. Well, it clicked with me. And it just so happened I could borrow a car that weekend. I mean, I didn't have a car, but somebody in the house I was living in at that time, because I'd moved to Manchester by this point, had asked me to pick up their car and said, "You can borrow it for the weekend." I don't think they meant you can drive to London for the weekend. But anyway, that's what Pete and I ended up doing, just on the basis of reading this review and the fact I could borrow this car. And it was, you know, the weekend that changed our lives.
To find out where the Pistols were playing, Howard and Pete visited the King's Road shop run by the band's manager, Malcolm McLaren. The shop was called Sex.
Howard was a guy, I think, that picked up on a small article in the NME about the Sex Pistols and how dreadful they were.
We first met Malcolm when we turned up at Sex, the shop on King's Road, having been told by Neil Spencer at the NME, who I'd phoned, that, I think their manager runs the sex shop on King's Road. So we were vaguely expecting to turn up to an Ann Summers-type shop.
So we started off at Sloane Square and walked our way all the way down and got there, and they were just closing up.
I kind of remember Jordan was there.
Working in the shop in King's Road, you would have people coming from absolutely everywhere to buy stuff there. It was a real treat. It was a pilgrimage, if you like.
Everything about the Sex Pistols impressed at that first gig we went to at High Wycombe.
It was something that kids could identify with and get their teeth into. So everybody was looking for something at the same time, in London anyway. And we was there, because we was thinking of those things already. But we was just that little bit ahead of the game. And we were like the standard bearers for the movement, and everybody rallied around us.
And Malcolm wanted, in the Pistols, to create the Bay City Rollers of Outrage. He wanted a band who couldn't play, who swore, who were just appalling, and who would be number one just because they were disgusting. And in fact, they became number one because they were fantastic, culturally, musically even, and in every way. So Malcolm failed. I always think, you know, he got screwed by art.
McNeish and Trafford saw the Sex Pistols twice that weekend. They decided two things: to bring the Pistols to Manchester and to change their names to Pete Shelley and Howard DeVoto.
The aggro of it was interesting. At that first gig, John got into a bit of a tussle with somebody in the audience and kept singing under a sort of small pile of people.
Then Howard was talking to Malcolm, and Malcolm was saying he wanted to have a gig outside of London, because all he could get was little gigs in London.
I went up to Malcolm after they'd played and said, if we could organise for you to play at our college, are you interested in coming up to do it? And he said, yeah.
And so the idea was that if you get something outside of London, then at least it's onwards and upwards, isn't it?
The powers that be at the Bolton Institute refused to let the Pistols play, talking themselves out of a place in rock history in the process. An alternative venue had to be found.
We found out we could hire the Lesser Free Trade Hall for, I think it's about £32 or something. And just doing the maths, we knew we got 40 people in, we'd be in profit, so it seemed like a good idea.
The Lesser Free Trade Hall, as if it's some kind of curious bird, you know, like a lesser spotted auditorium or something. So that first gig for, you know, for the 4th of June 1976 was suddenly on the cards.
The Manchester Free Trade Hall was like this cathedral of conventional established sounds, and you'd see your Pink Floyds and your David Bowies and your T-Rexes, and so that was incredibly exciting.
But the Free Trade Hall was sort of not sacred, but it was like a place you went to, and it was like so, you know, crap.
I suppose it is, after all, the only civic building that I know of that's named after a radical political movement, the Free Trade Movement, the Anti-Corn Law League. Italianate is what people tend to call it. And as with a lot of buildings at the time, it's all front. It's always been a place where young people and audiences have gathered in order to express themselves in one way or another. I'm referring to the famous night in 1965 when a member of the audience at the Manchester Free Trade Hall, not the Albert Hall in London, as has been commonly thought for many a long year, actually stood up and accused Bob Dylan of being Judas. Strong words, in my view.
The hall was booked, and the plan was for Pete and Howard's band to be the support act. But the Buzzcocks, as they were now known, weren't ready, so a replacement had to be brought in.
Because we weren't ready, we needed to draft somebody else in, and it was like, you know, to play support. And it was like, we didn't know anybody to do that. The only thing I could remember was this guy I think his name was Jeff, that I'd worked with the previous summer at a mail order warehouse in Manchester.
There's a band called the Mandela Band, I don't know. which one it was. And they're a bit hippie trippy type thing, I think, because I never saw them because I was collecting the tickets.
I'm convinced it was a group called Solstice, not the Mandala Band. I just remember the guy, his name was Jeff, in this white boiler suit.
So, on Friday the 4th of June 1976, between 20 or 100 people, depending on who you believe, headed for the Lesser Free Trade Hall to see the Sex Pistols, supported by a progressive rock act.
I'll never forget it, because Malcolm McLaren walked in the pub, right, in the vault, and he had, like, a leather suit on, right, you know, big ginger hair and that, which was, like, pretty, you know, unusual in them days, you know. Like, winkle pickers on the head and all that, you know. And he just walked over to us, he said, are you going over, yeah, to see the, you know what I mean? That sort of really impressed me, it was a good management style, like, you know what I mean? So in the pub and said, you know, you're going to see, you know, we were saying, like, we're weighing it up, you know what I mean?
The way they were dressed was absolutely bizarre, and Malcolm McLaren being all dressed in leather in the ticket booth, giving out the tickets as you walked in. And then he came and sat on the end of our row, Malcolm McLaren, and, you know, I'd never seen anybody bloody dressed in leather. I mean, I've seen Alvin Stardust on telly, but I'd never seen anything like that in my life, and we were all like, oh. Well, it was like he was an alien. It was great.
I would say 30 to 50 people tops were there, and the only person that I can say for sure was there is Tony Wilson, because I actually spoke to him.
Was Alan at it? Fucking hell.
And I spoke to him because I'd met him at... I'd been to see Kiss the month before at the Free Trade Hall, the big hall downstairs, and they'd played in the May.
So if some guy says he saw me there and we talked about the Kiss gig, that's probably very, very correct, actually.
I've no strong recollection of him being at the first one. I don't actually remember him coming up to the box office. I say I'm on the guest list or anything like that.
The only people, apart from Pete, myself, Steve Diglin and all the Pistols crew, I'd be reasonably certain were there, were Paul Morley, Morrissey, John the Postman.
Excuse me, what?
John the Postman went to every early punk gig in Manchester, eventually joining many bands on stage for a sing-along.
I didn't know anybody else. I mean, there was no scene then, so that was, like, kind of the start of it. So the only people I knew there were my immediate friends I went with. Like, I mean, I'm sure Tony Wilson wasn't there.
It doesn't matter who was there, just the fact that there was enough people there.
The support band worried me because they were just another typical rock band playing rock music, and I thought, have I wasted a Friday night here? Is this, are the Sex Pistols just going to be another version of this, dressed up differently?
They were like old, complete dyed-in-the-wool, normal, deep purple-type, Led Zeppelin-type rockers.
They were like, you know, the arse end of prog rock. In fact, they actually did a cover version of Nantucket Sleigh Ride by Mountain. I think they were from Eccles or Swinton or, you know, various parts of Salford, and they were dreadful.
My abiding memory of the support group is that the singer had I seem to recall him having a droopy moustache, but he was also sporting a love bite on his neck. They did this absolutely faithful version of the Nantucket Sleigh Ride by Mountain. It was the theme tune of a famous political programme which you might remember called Weekend World, which was hosted by Brian Walden at the time. So I knew that, and I remember taking it off the telly when I was about 13. That's a great track. So they played that one.
You know, they were the most inappropriate group to really have, but in another sense, they lulled us into a false sense of security and made what was about to happen even more dramatic.
I like Mountain, but I can't remember that. See, the thing is, I was more like in Tommy Ducks when they was on.
It was very polite applause at first, and then they came on with, like I say, Nantucket Sleigh Ride. You know, everybody was quite keen on that one. And then they shuffled off, and the main act came on.
Johnny Rotten ambled on, and that was like just a shock, just to see him, because he was like one of the most frightening people I've ever seen at that time. I said to you, this like 1,000-yard stare, and just stood there. They hadn't even started playing. And it was as though he was just staring at me. He was probably just looking out into the audience, but I remember feeling so frightened.
My friend, who was sat right next to me, he's a bit of a wag. And of course, he shouts out, no applause as they come on stage, and he just shouts out, you're not very sexy, are you? To which John Rotten actually just shot him with this look. and just looked down at him and said with this pathetic sneer on his face, "Why, do you want some sex?"
My prime memory is of me being like that, and I think everyone else was just like that. It was shock.
It was very weird because you never knew what was going to happen. You'd turn up somewhere and people didn't know who the Sex Pistols were and they'd just come in to see a gig. And you'd get a bad reception and, you know, it was very groundbreaking. People were blinking amazed and blown away by it.
It was absolutely bizarre. It was the most sort of, like, shocking thing I've ever seen in my life. It was just unbelievable. And the sound was terrible.
You don't like it, fuck off then.
God, I've been waiting for this. God, it's real. For me personally, academically, it wasn't until about the seventh number, which were, they did all these other numbers, and the seventh number was Stepping Stone. I almost out, which you can imagine Johnny singing. And suddenly there, a song that you knew, being done by this bunch of maniacs, then you began to understand what, you know, what they were actually doing. What they were doing was just playing ridiculously fast, energetic. They were just doing it, you know, and putting loads of energy and just doing it properly.
And they were playing short, sharp songs. Even the version of Stepping Stone was a wonder to behold.
Intimidation on legs, it was. You know? First time ever, after watching other bands play, then these guys came out and bang, it was there.
What surprises me, we were supposed to have short hair, and it's quite how long our hair is back then, you know, but it was short compared with everybody. I mean, even the cab driver had his hair, you know, just over his ears back then, everybody had flares on. So, yeah, we were quite different, but it does look quite tame in comparison with what punks are supposed to look like these days, you know, with the hair up there and all that. That'll come later. We never see ourselves as a punk band. We hated the term punk. We were the Sex Pistols.
A lot of people in hindsight say to me what they liked about them was that they were rubbish, but they didn't sound rubbish to me. They sounded magnificent.
Well, it was erotically charged. The whole thing was erotic. It was just, you know, the funny thing is they could play really well, and that amongst the more kind of, you know, pseudos of us was something that was important too. You know, it wasn't a shambles at all. They were very powerful.
Steve Jones was wearing a boiler suit and his entire act was a Pete Townsend impersonation. He was doing all that and doing the whole Pete Townsend thing.
We just looked at each other and thought, my God, you know, they looked like they were having such a fantastic time and it was so alien to everything. You just thought, God, we could do that.
The Pistols, or John in particular, was obviously quite pleased with the reaction they got, because when he... when they came on and did their encore, you know, he said something to the crowd like, "Where did you all come from?" In a not unfriendly way.
My only other memory of June the 4th is as I walked out, there's this geezer in his black leather, and he goes, "Well, what do you think of that then, Mr. Wilson?" And I said, "Well, Malcolm, I think, yeah, but the Pete Townsend stuff." He went, "Yeah, yeah, I know, it's going, it's going."
I mean, when you came out, you knew something had happened and your body felt hot and your blood was racing and your mind was racing and you were thinking, you know, this is amazing. But it never occurred to you that there would be any future for it. It never occurred to you that maybe every single person in that room would go on and form bands and do whatever they did. It never occurred to you because that never happened before. And in Manchester, music scene was often, you know, a kind of poppy thing, Herman's and Hermits, 10cc. So it never occurred to you that anything fantastic could come from Manchester. And it never occurred to you that even though the thing we'd just seen was so fantastic, that it would all inspire us to do things, you know. It was just a fantastic experience, and you went home and then, must be a surprise, a few days later, you found out it was going to happen again.
Malcolm said to me afterwards something like, "Let's do it again."
And so then the idea was to do another one. So July the 20th was the first one, was the second one. So it was only about 6 weeks, and the Sex Pistols had played twice in Manchester.
Literally the next day, I went to Maisel's in Manchester when it was on Piccadilly Approach, and bought a bass guitar for £35. And I went in and went, "Can I have a bass guitar?" And he went, "Oh, here's one." And he gave it me. And I said, "You know, how much is that?" He said, £35. I said, "Right." Give him £35 and walked out with this guitar. I thought, what the bloody hell am I going to do with this now?
In part two of I Swear I Was There, it's Buzzcocks versus Slaughter and the Dogs as the Pistols return to Manchester.
Come with us.
Despite the fact the Buzzcocks had organised the second Pistols gig on July the 20th, another band was added to the lineup, pushing the Buzzcocks to the bottom of the bill. It created a rivalry that lasts to this day.
Getting the group together, organising the gig, going along to check out Slaughter and the Dogs.
And hi to all the guys in Withenshaw.
Yeah, yeah.
Hope you're doing well, guys.
Yeah.
We did travel out to Withenshaw and saw them play. Not that they glammed themselves up when we went to see them play. So when Slaughter and the Dogs turned out to be kind of Bowie Roxy kids, it was a bit, oh, we hadn't quite realised that about you.
There was nothing, literally nothing in Withenshaw. Labour clubs and Tom Jones, people singing Tom Jones impersonations, and bingo.
We were told at school by our headmaster, Mr. Muscat, if you're still alive and still kicking,
jeez,
hello.
That's a blast from the past.
Yeah. he said, he got us into his room once, and he said to us that we'd end up all on the dole or in prison, and we wouldn't ever work.
That's encouragement for you, right?
So that is, you know, if you're in... if you're in school and somebody says that to you, just go out and say, you know, what am I supposed to do, kill myself? And we did the other way around kind of thing. We just said, OK, he said that, we're going to make something out of ourselves. And that pushed us, basically.
We did the Forum, the Withenshire Forum, which is a real big place, and it's unheard of for anyone to... And it was promoted by our manager, so it was off our own back, we sort of did that.
It was his back. Because Ray did a lot, our manager for
my brother at the time.
Yeah. He still is with his brother.
Hey, Ray, how you doing, man? Yeah.
Mike Rossi thought that Slaughter and the Dogs was the best band in all the world, and they could get in 20 million people and sell all these tickets.
I liked them. I thought they was a fun kind of band. I didn't really consider them to be a punk band, although they got involved with that because that was what was going at the time.
I just went because a friend asked me to go because Slaughter and the Dogs were playing. I'd never heard of punk. Nobody knew what punk was. She just said, "Do you want to come and see Slaughter and the Dogs?" And I said, "Oh yeah, I'll go." Yeah, and it was just like that, and that's how I ended up there.
The gig, as it went, for us was just like doing a labour club, basically. Except it was a little bit bigger.
This is where Bowie played. This is where Lou Reed did White Light, White Heat. This is where Mick Ronson did Slaughter on 10th Avenue. We were in the bill, just to be under the same roof as that. Yeah.
When I was on stage, I could say that I knew, let's say, 80% of the people who were there.
They were too cocky for me, Slaughter and the Dogs. I didn't like them. They were too arrogant. They were like real little wide boys. And I remember we used to share a practice place, TJ Davidson's. And Slaughter and the Dogs used to wait for all the bands to go home, and then you used to go and steal your gear. And it was quite clanny. It was quite clanny. The whole music scene was very clanny. And you'd come in and Bleeding Slaughter and Dogs had done it again. You know, bleeding hell. And you'd have to go around and go, all right. And they'd give you your mics back and give you your amps back. It was so, they're really annoying.
They also produced their own posters with Slaughter and the Dogs and Sex Pistols down there, which was no mention of Buzzcocks at all, which was sweet of them. Punk was never a loving world with everybody blissed out together and being jolly supportive. I mean, you know, it ain't like that in showbiz, is it?
We were desperate to get onto that bill because it was the publicity was building for it and there was a lot of media interest in it. And there was talk about getting the Buzzcocks out of the way, you know, and trying to find their address to go down and beat them up or something, you know, so they couldn't play. So it was even going to wait outside on the night and do it, you know, but we got talked out of it.
So, with backstage rivalry simmering, the Buzzcocks took to the stage for their first real gig.
Well, we didn't really have time to be nervous. I mean, being nervous is a luxury when you've got time to think. I just remember Malcolm saying, if Buzzcocks aren't on in 5 minutes, they're not going on. So you just have to get ready and on you go.
Buzzcocks played, but I think it was their first gig, and in fact he had a guitar that was only half a guitar because he didn't like the top off and just cut it off with a tenon saw.
The worst thing to do always is to show the audience fear, because they can smell it.
For me, the revelation of that show was Buzzcocks.
You're not, aren't you? But I remember thinking we could do better than that.
We were out there for 20 minutes and we got away with it and people clapped and, you know. We were in the music papers the following week.
Next on were Slaughter and the Dogs. They knock out their glam rock stompers in what can only be described as blouses. The mood in the Lesser Free Trade Hall begins to darken.
My first ever punk statement was flinging peanuts at Wayne Barrett because I thought he looked like a really dodgy kind of copy of Brian Ferry or something, you know what I mean? I'd never ever been a hooligan in my life, I'd never been naughty at school, and suddenly, faced with Wayne Barrett's hair, I just had to throw something at him to say, you are inauthentic!
Anyway, we went off in a big fight, I remember Paul Morley trying to get everybody, come on, Manx, come on, let's get the Cockneys, all running round and all that, that was amazing.
There was a big split in the audience that second time, yeah. Between, the punks, you know, before it was punk, if you know what I mean.
There were all these wimpy, young sort of girls and blokes at the front, like, waving flags about as if it was a Bay City Rollers gig, which me and my friends were found totally horrendous and disgusting.
I'm not quite sure if it was the Buzzcocks and Slaughter and the Dogs were having a scrap at the side of the stage. It was like an Eric Morecambe thing. The curtain kept flicking and somebody kept on dashing back on the other side there.
Yeah, there was a big security team down there from Withinshaw. Maybe they were starting most of the fights anyway, I think, you know, if it wasn't going to kick off. They'd probably been told to start trouble with there being a lot of press down there, you know, so they'd get the publicity going.
We'd done our sound check and it was great and we were all happy. And then the Pistols had their sound check and Steve started the Chords of Anarchy. Na-na-na-na-na-na-na. I thought, well, that sounds fucking good.
But when the Sex Pistols came on, it just all kicked off.
As far as I can remember, it sort of broke out in serious violence and there was a lot of chair smashing and things.
Because I remember him doing Anarchy and it was just like, I thought, yeah, that's a single. I am an anti-Christ. I am an anarchist. Don't know what I want, but I know how to get it. I want to destroy, pacify, because
with the gig over, the most important part of the evening was still to come, sorting out the money.
Malcolm had his hand fairly firmly on the tiller of the money boat.
All the proceeds went to Malcolm. He took the proceeds. We got £10 as our fee for our first gig. So, I don't know what happened to the rest of the money.
And they were upstairs counting the money on the balcony, remember? Yeah. Yeah. And Malcolm's going, one for you, one for me, one up the trouser leg, one for you, one behind the back, yeah. And it was like the three-card thing, you know. Yeah,
that's a true story. He must have screwed us for around about 150 quid, something like that.
Allegedly.
If the gig in June had been the sort of detonation, then that second gig was the cloud, where everybody knew something was going off.
I nearly ran them over on Oxford Road on the Sex Pistols on the way to the second day. They were going across the Burger House on Oxford Road. Could have changed musical history, couldn't it, really?
The next part of the plan put forward the unthinkable. Let's put the Sex Pistols on television for the very first time. It happened at Granada TV on September the 1st, 1976.
This night after I saw the Pistols, I went running into my boss and said,
Chris, got it, sorry. Saw this band last night, got to have them on. Saw this band, fantastic.
Hey, man, he said, I saw this great gig, and, you know, and we all said, fine, you know, because Tony didn't describe things in detail most of the time. Tony just came in with a kind of wave of enthusiasm, you know. Saw this great Irish band, Common Man. They were just groovy. And so we booked them. Or Sex Pistols, so they were, oh, you wouldn't believe it, man. We booked them. It was all sort of enthusiasm that drove the show.
We'd all have singles and records to listen to. We'd all have ideas of who we wanted to get in the programme. He would say, when are we going to get the Sex Pistols on? Oh, Tony Belter, we can't have them on. They're not, you know, they're not musical. They're not musicians. They're just layabouts. No, forget it. And I don't know what happened, but I think Chris eventually relented under pressure and said, OK, yeah, we'll have them on the last show.
So It Goes was supposed to be a showcase for unsigned bands. It turned into a showcase for a total change in music.
It was, a normal schedule. We had a studio and cameraman turned up and the sound guys turned up and, you know, the floor manager wore the headphones. It was all quite normal. Until the Sex Pistols turned up.
Getting a TV show was one more step up the ladder, you know. And we considered it our right to be on the TV.
I think John was a bit nervy about it on the way up, because I remember the train journey, and it was a bit of a worry. But once he got there, once he saw Tony Wilson with his jeans jacket and his clogs, we knew we'd made it.
1, 2, 3.
Good evening. As well as a renegade French lecturer's impressions of the recent Nebworth Festival, tonight's So It Goes also includes impressions, many of them fleeting, of Clive James, Peter Cook, Batman, Jerry Lee Lewis, and tonight's star rock critic.
The Sex Pistols are, if possible, even better than the lovely Joni Mitchell.
What was fantastic about it was that Tony Wilson in the Northwest in 76, 77, 78 was like John Stapleton or Richard Madeley. And kind of looked like that. Yeah, you know, Tony, as much as he was on it very quickly, always was one step behind, so he still had the long hair and the flares and the leather blouson jacket.
Music companies were all full of hippies, really. But we didn't really expect Tony to be a hippie. We gave him such a hard time. I'm so sorry, Tony, in retrospect.
I broke a string in the first number and didn't have a spare guitar or anything, so somebody had to go all the way to the dressing rooms, which was the other end of the studios, and bring the string back, and I laboriously put it on, and Tony Wilson was trying to chat right up, you know, why wouldn't you come and talk to me, because, you know, are you afraid to talk to us? And I just piped up, no, because you're a He crumbled, all the audience laughed, and then Clive James was on the show, and he thought, oh, well, I'm going to take Rotten on, you know, and just Rotten just made mincemeat of him, absolute mincemeat of him.
And I think he was feeling upstaged or something along those lines. Anyway, John and I laid into him really badly and called him a baldy old Sheila at the top of our voices. You baldy old Sheila.
The musical divide created by punk in 1976 was here for all to see on So It Goes. First band on are called Gentlemen.
I remember nothing about Gentlemen, obviously, because who would have a, you know, crap name like Gentlemen? That's a stupid name for a group. Don't know why we ever had them on. Gentlemen. Come on, do me a favour.
Next, the Bowles Brothers.
I remember we were sitting in the dressing room listening to this band that was like a folk band with a double bass, and couldn't believe, we didn't know what we had let ourselves in for.
As rehearsals continued, it became obvious that one thing had to go. Jordan's swastika armband was judged to be the final straw.
And Sidney Bernstein, who effectively owned the company, he was the chairman of the company, and was an older man, he'd been skimming through the channels and come across the Sex Pistols on in the studio rehearsing, and Sidney, for a man of his age and his generation and his background, was really, really upset by this. He thought it was absolutely outrageous that we should be transmitting somebody with a swastika armband on a Granada programme.
And everyone got involved, and there was a great big do over it, and then some bright spark came up with the idea that they would stick a piece of white tape over it, which I didn't want, Malcolm didn't want, there was another argument. And in the end, it came down to either you don't go on the show or you have it censored.
And eventually, when we went on the air, the armband had not come off, but the swastika itself had been covered up, which was a sufficient compromise.
One of the most reviewed and most reviled rock phenomenon of recent weeks, we got a few votes, Sex Pistols. You can hear them warming up in the background even now.
Whatever your view on the Sex Pistols, whatever your view on their music, what happened next has gone down in history as one of the greatest moments in rock and roll television. Get off your ass!
When you see a band, that you see them and they're on stage because they have no fucking choice, which is what all great bands look like. I am an antichrist!
They were totally committed to performance, and they saved that performance for when they knew the cameras were rolling, and when they knew, and they didn't give us that before. So there was like a sudden burst of energy came off the stage, and it took everybody by the throat and shook us, you know. Whoa, whoa, oh my God, what's going on? What's going on? What's happening?
I remember them being very effective. I also remember Jordan's not entirely successful attempt to try and get a bit of trouble going down at the front of the stage by kind of knocking a plastic chair over.
It was truly bizarre. Not just the other bands, but the audience. Really close to the audience there, and they were just like, they look like prisoners waiting to die.
And the whole thing ended with all the chaos and all the gear falling apart, with him just staring into the lens, really, really long, long stare.
Well, I'm sitting there with a large grin on my face, but the rest of this entire audience is just... And it's the wonderful thing is when the last note hits and stops, there's complete silence. 200 people. There's nothing, just silence, except suddenly you hear, and it's Chris Pye. He's come running out of the control box and he's coming down the stairs to hit one of them.
No, I think I may have gone through with a lie down at that stage.
Bakunin would have loved it. That was Sex Pistols, the leaders in their field.
I can't believe I said that. If I did say that, did I say that? Oh, God. Well, and the idea that I am a posing bloody idiot is fairly correct.
But anyway, we did the show, and that was it. Yeah. And then we went off, had a drink and dressed room, come back, because I'd left my bass out here. And there was an old boy sweeping up, sort of little maroon, grey cardigan on. And he said, was you in that band? I said, yeah, why? I thought he was going to tick me off, you know, for, like, being young reprobates. And he said, it's about fucking time that somebody fucking winded up that fucking bunch of fucking sausage. Great, good for you. It's about 65, this bloke. I'll see you later.
In part three of I Swear I Was There, playing live, the punks in the present day. The two Pistols gigs in Manchester, and their first TV appearance, changed rock music forever. It created the independent record scene, it inspired the audience to make their own music, and made a generation believe they could do it too.
all the way through, you know, Joy Division to the Stone Roses, from the Fall to Happy Mondays, all the way through to the damp stuff that happened, anything mad that happened at the Hacienda. You know, you can all draw it back to that little explosion at the Leicester Free Trade Hall. Easy, it's not hard at all, you know.
It left in all those of us who wanted to live real lives, it was like we were dried kindling, just ready, you know, absolutely ready to explode into fire.
Everything that in Manchester of any cultural significance to this day you can trace in some way back to the Sex Pistols playing at the Leicester Free Trade Hall.
Well, so I'm told, and I know people who are at gig, but I mean, when you're in a band, you kind of get in a van and you get taken to where you're going. And what happens when you get there is not totally within your hands, you know.
Howard Devoto left the Buzzcocks just as they were about to become big. 24 years after they split, Pete and Howard are back together.
In some kind of curious turn of events, Pete Shelley and myself have found ourselves working again together.
But it's been really good working with Howard, because in some ways I'd forgotten about how mad he was in the first place to start Buzzcocks.
It's a very different world of musical work. It's computers, you don't sit around with a guitar anymore in your front room. You still sit around in your front room, but it's with a computer more than a guitar.
The bass guitar Peter Hook bought the day after seeing the Sex Pistols served him well, with Joy Division, New Order and Monaco.
I can remember we did a gig with the Buzzcocks at the Electric Circus, and Pete Shelley, he said, now stop spitting, all of you, stop spitting, all of you, please stop, we're not playing anymore until you stop spitting.
Don't gob at me! This one's a nice pop song.
And he went, right, now that's better. And he just went to go 1, 2, 3, 4, and they all smashed at him. Oh, God. Fantastic moments in punk history.
The Sex Pistols reformed for a world tour in 1996. Glenn Matlock parted company with the Pistols in 1977. A quarter of a century on from the Sex Pistols, here he is, playing at a club across the road from the Leicester Free Trade Hall.
Go away and crawl under a stone just because it suits everybody else. Well, no, fuck that. To me, music is communicating with people, and you can sit in a studio forever and a day, you know, make some big magnum opus and never see anybody. To me, music is picking up a guitar and playing in front of somebody and getting some feedback straight away. If you don't relate to people, it's just wanking, really.
We'll be right back.
Mark E. Smith is still lead singer of The Fall. Anthony Wilson now runs an internet music site. Jordan is still doing her own thing.
I'm a veterinary nurse, and I breed Burmese cats and show them. And I have some grand champion and champion pussycats.
Okay. Don't know if any of you guys know about this, but there's been a punk documentary which was filmed here tonight as well.
Mick Rossi now lives in Los Angeles. Wayne Barrett lives in France. They still get together as Slaughter and the Dogs, knocking out their glam rock stompers at punk festivals.
So this song is dedicated to you all who are there, who were there, and Granada Television. I haven't got a talcum powder. I'm sorry, mate. Began on my life, Wayne was a real dog boozer. Made letters roll like a pixie loser. Looked around, I destroyed. I thought I was there, but there was no one. Here we go, thanks. All ideas, I'm shaking my fist, grab the billion star heads in my wrist. Hallucinations in my dreams. Oh, I'm gonna leave, I'm gonna leave this sea. All ideas, I'm shaking my fist, grab the billion star at this point. I thought I was laying, but there was no point. Trying to really hide. Trying to really hide. And I'm a fly. I'm a fucking fly. Okay, shoot.
As soon as we hit in rehearsal, and you know, we strike up a chord or whatever song it is, but there's this and a little wry smile there. It's never, we've never lost that.
Back.
And just hearing the entire crowd sing the lyrics, as you kind of turn around and go, oh, fucking great, isn't it, you know?
The Lesser Free Trade Hall in Manchester is now closed.